Article 3, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary. Importance of this article. From what has been said in the preceding article, the faithful can understand that in bringing us from the relentless tyranny of Satan into liberty, God has conferred a singular and surpassing blessing on the human race. But if we place before our eyes also the plan and means by which he deigned chiefly to accomplish this, then, indeed, we shall see that there is nothing more glorious or magnificent than this divine goodness and beneficence towards us. First part of this article. Who was conceived? The pastor, then, should enter on the exposition of this third article by developing the grandeur of this mystery, which the sacred scriptures very frequently propose for our consideration as the principal source of our eternal salvation. Its meaning he should teach to be that we believe and confess that the same Jesus Christ, our only Lord, the Son of God, when he assumed human flesh for us in the womb of the Virgin, was not conceived like other men, from the seed of man, but in a manner transcending the order of nature, that is, by the power of the Holy Ghost, so that the same person, remaining God as he was from eternity, became man, what he was not before. That such is the meaning of the above words is clear from the Creed of the Holy Council of Constantinople, which says, "Who for us men, and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and became incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man." The same truth we also find unfolded by Saint John the Evangelist, who imbibed from the bosom of the Lord and Savior himself the knowledge of this most profound mystery. For when he had declared the nature of the divine Word as follows, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God," he concluded, "and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us." The Word, which is a person of the divine nature, assumed human nature in such a manner that there should be one and the same person in both the divine and human natures. Hence this admirable union preserved the actions and properties of both natures, and as Pope Saint Leo the Great said, "The lowliness of the inferior nature was not consumed in the glory of the superior, nor did the assumption of the inferior lessen the glory of the superior." By the Holy Ghost. As an explanation of the words in which this article is expressed is not to be omitted, the pastor should teach that when we say that the Son of God was conceived by the power of the Holy Ghost, we do not mean that this person alone of the Holy Trinity accomplished the mystery of the Incarnation. Although the Son only assumed human nature, yet all the persons of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, were authors of this mystery. It is a principle of Christian faith that whatever God does outside himself in creation is common to the three persons, and that one neither does more than, nor acts without another. But that one emanates from another, this only cannot be common to all, for the Son is begotten of the Father only, and the Holy Ghost proceeds from the Father and the Son. Anything, however, which proceeds from them extrinsically is the work of the three persons without difference of any sort, and of this latter description is the incarnation of the Son of God. Of those things, nevertheless, that are common to all, the sacred scriptures often attribute some to one person, some to another. Thus, to the Father they attribute power over all things, to the Son, wisdom, to the Holy Ghost, love. Hence, as the mystery of the Incarnation manifests the singular and boundless love of God towards us, it is therefore in some sort peculiarly attributed to the Holy Ghost. In the Incarnation some things were natural, others supernatural. In this mystery we perceive that some things were done which transcend the order of nature, some by the power of nature. Thus, in believing that the body of Christ was formed from the most pure blood of his Virgin Mother, we acknowledge the apparition of human nature, this being a law common to the formation of all human bodies, that they should be formed from the blood of the Mother. But what surpasses the order of nature and human comprehension is, that as soon as the Blessed Virgin assented to the announcement of the angel in these words, "Behold the handmaid of the Lord, be it done unto me according to thy word," the most sacred body of Christ was immediately formed, and to it was united a rational soul enjoying the use of reason, and thus in the same instant of time he was perfect God and perfect man. That this was the astonishing and admirable work of the Holy Ghost cannot be doubted, for according to the order of nature the rational soul is united to the body only after a certain lapse of time. Again, and this should overwhelm us with astonishment. As soon as the soul of Christ was united to his body, the divinity became united to both, and thus at the same time his body was formed and animated, and the divinity united to body and soul. Hence, at the same instant he was perfect God and perfect man, and the Most Holy Virgin, having at the same moment conceived God and man, is truly and properly called Mother of God and man. This the angel signified to her when he said, "Behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and shalt bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Most High." The event verified the prophecy of Isaiah: "Behold, a virgin shall conceive, and bear a son." Elizabeth also declared the same truth when being filled with the Holy Ghost. She understood the conception of the Son of God, and said, "Whence is this to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" As the body of Christ was formed of the pure blood of the Immaculate Virgin without the aid of man, as we have already said, and by the sole operation of the Holy Ghost, so also, at the moment of his conception, his soul was enriched with an overflowing fullness of the Spirit of God, and a superabundance of all graces. For God gave not to him, as to others adorned with holiness and grace, his Spirit by measure, as Saint John testifies, but poured into his soul the plenitude of all graces so abundantly that of his fullness we all have received. Although possessing the Spirit by which holy men attain the adoption of sons of God, he cannot, however, be called the adopted Son of God, for since he is the Son of God by nature, the grace, or name of adoption, can on no account be deemed applicable to him. How to profit by the mystery of the Incarnation? These truths comprise the substance of what appears to demand explanation regarding the admirable mystery of the conception. To reap from them abundant fruit for salvation, the faithful should particularly recall, and frequently reflect, that it is God who assumed human flesh, that the manner in which he became man exceeds our comprehension, not to say our powers of expression, and finally, that he vouchsafed to become man in order that we men might be born again as children of God. When to these subjects they shall have given mature consideration, let them, in the humility of faith, believe and adore all the mysteries contained in this article, and not indulge a curious inquisitiveness by investigating and scrutinizing them, an attempt scarcely ever unattended with danger. Second part of this article, Born of the Virgin Mary. These words comprise another part of this article. In its exposition, the pastor should exercise considerable diligence, because the faithful are bound to believe that Jesus the Lord was not only conceived by the power of the Holy Ghost, but was also born of the Virgin Mary. The words of the angel who first announced the happy tidings to the world declare with what joy and delight of soul this mystery of our faith should be meditated upon. "Behold," said the angel, "I bring you good tidings of great joy that shall be to all the people." The same sentiments are clearly conveyed in the song chanted by the heavenly host: "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men of good will." Then began the fulfillment of the splendid promise made by God to Abraham that in his seed all the nations of the earth should one day be blessed. For Mary, whom we truly proclaim and venerate as Mother of God, because she brought forth him who is at once God and man, was descended from King David. The nativity of Christ transcends the order of nature. But as the conception itself transcends the order of nature, so also the birth of our Lord presents to our contemplation nothing but what is divine. Besides, what is admirable beyond the power of thoughts or words to express, he is born of his mother without any diminution of her maternal virginity, just as he afterwards went forth from the sepulchre while it was closed and sealed, and entered the room in which his disciples were assembled, the doors being shut, or, not to depart from everyday examples, just as the rays of the sun penetrate without breaking or injuring in the least the solid substance of glass, so after a like but more exalted manner did Jesus Christ come forth from his mother's womb without injury to her maternal virginity. This immaculate and perpetual virginity forms, therefore, the just theme of our eulogy. Such was the work of the Holy Ghost, who at the conception and birth of the Son so favored the Virgin Mother as to impart to her fecundity while preserving inviolate her perpetual virginity. Christ compared to Adam Mary to Eve. The apostle sometimes calls Jesus Christ the second Adam, and compares him to the first Adam, for as in the first all men die, so in the second all are made alive, and as in the natural order Adam was the father of the human race, so in the supernatural order Christ is the author of grace and of glory. The Virgin Mother we may also compare to Eve, making the second Eve, that is, Mary, correspond to the first, as we have already shown that the second Adam, that is, Christ, corresponds to the first Adam. By believing the serpent, Eve brought malediction and death on mankind, and Mary, by believing the angel, became the instrument of the divine goodness in bringing life and benediction to the human race. From Eve we are born children of wrath, from Mary we have received Jesus Christ, and through him are regenerated children of grace. To Eve it was said, "In sorrow shalt thou bring forth children." Mary was exempt from this law, for preserving her virginal integrity inviolate she brought forth Jesus the Son of God without experiencing, as we have already said, any sense of pain. Times and prophecies of the conception and nativity. The mysteries of this admirable conception and nativity being, therefore, so great and so numerous, it accorded with the plan of divine providence to signify them by many types and prophecies. Hence the Holy Fathers understood many things which we meet in the sacred scriptures to refer to these mysteries, particularly that gate of the sanctuary which Ezekiel saw closed, the stone cut out of the mountain without hands, which became a great mountain and filled the universe, of which we read in Daniel, the rod of Aaron, which alone budded of all the rods of the princes of Israel, and the bush which Moses saw burr without being consumed. The Holy Evangelist describes in detail the history of the birth of Christ, but, as the pastor can easily recur to the sacred volume, it is unnecessary for us to say more on the subject. Lessons which this article teaches. The pastor should labor to impress deeply on the minds and hearts of the faithful these mysteries, which were written for our learning, first, that by the commemoration of so great a benefit they may make some return of gratitude to God, its author, and next, in order to place before their eyes, as a model for imitation, this striking and singular example of humility. Humility and poverty of Christ. What can be more useful, what better calculated to subdue the pride and haughtiness of the human heart, than to reflect frequently that God humbles himself in such a manner as to assume our frailty and weakness, in order to communicate to us his glory, that God becomes man, and that he at whose nod, to use the words of Scripture, the pillars of heaven tremble and are affrighted bows his supreme and infinite majesty to minister to man, that he whom the angels adore in heaven is born on earth. When such is the goodness of God towards us, what, I ask, should we not do to testify our obedience to his will? With what willingness and alacrity should we not love, embrace, and perform all the duties of humility? The faithful should also consider the salutary lessons which Christ at his birth teaches before he begins to speak. He is born in poverty, he is born a stranger under a roof not his own, he is born in a lonely crib, he is born in the depth of winter. For Saint Luke writes as follows, "And it came to pass, that when they were there, her days were accomplished, that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn, and wrapped him up in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." Could the evangelist have described under more humble terms the majesty and glory that filled the heavens and the earth? He does not say, "There was no room in the inn," but "There was no room for him who says, 'The world is mine, and the fullness thereof.'" As another evangelist has expressed it, "He came unto his own, and his own received him not." Elevation and dignity of man. When the faithful have placed these things before their eyes, let them also reflect that God condescended to assume the lowliness and frailty of our flesh in order to exalt man to the highest degree of dignity. This single reflection, that he who is true and perfect God became man, supplies sufficient proof of the exalted dignity conferred on the human race by the divine bounty, since we may now glory that the sons of God is bone of our bone, and flesh of our flesh. A privilege not given to angels, for nowhere, says the apostle, doth he take hold of the angels, but of the seed of Abraham he taketh hold. Duty of spiritual nativity. We must also take care lest to our great injury it should happen that just as there was no room for him in the inn at Bethlehem, in which to be born, so likewise now, after he has been born in the flesh, he should find no room in our hearts in which to be born spiritually. For since he is most desirous of our salvation, this spiritual birth is the object of his most earnest solicitude. As, then, by the power of the Holy Ghost, and in a manner superior to the order of nature, he was made man and was born, was holy and even holiness itself, so does it become our duty to be born, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, but of God, to walk as new creatures in newness of spirit, and to preserve that holiness and purity of soul which so much becomes men regenerated by the Spirit of God. Thus shall we reflect some faint image of the holy conception and nativity of the Son of God, which are the objects of our firm faith, and believing which we revere and adore the wisdom of God in a mystery which is hidden.